Hello everybody, welcome to Hat Hole Home Video. Today I decided, I'd been doing some thrifting, found a, you know, an interesting thing or two here or there, but a lot of my usual thrifting haunts had not really bore fruit this last week or so, so I decided to go a little outside of my normal radius. My thrifting zone, my perimeter, not boundaries. There's probably a better word that I can't think of. My territory. We'll say that. Territory. That's a good word. Went a little further outside my territory to a retro gaming store called Punch Out Gaming in Forest Lake, Minnesota. Give them a little shout out because they're, a tremendous little shop. And I ended up getting some pretty cool stuff. A lot of boxed things, good prices. So I got a little more than I necessarily expected when I walked in. That's not always a bad thing. Not always a good thing if you're, you know, on a budget. But these were good deals. So let's look at what I picked up. Huh? All right. First up, we got a few boxed NES games. Now, don't go thinking anything's going to be in mint condition, although one is in really good condition. But this is, for me, I don't want to say holy grail, but I want, semi-holy grail. We'll put it that way. This is a game that I've been looking to add to the collection for a long time. It's a game that I remembered renting from a local gas station when I was a kid, the Tom Thumb. That was just like a couple doors down from me where I grew up, had a very small, I think it was literally one shelf. It was probably like here to here, just one little shelf of Nintendo games to rent. And one game that I specifically remember renting from the Tom Thumb gas station back in the, maybe it was early 90s, but I'm guessing late 80s. Well, the game's 1990, so it's probably 1990. Is this Wall Street Kid? Does anybody remember this game? Back when we loved capitalism, right? Teach 'em young. But I remember thinking this game was so cool. I liked kind of like life sim games. And this was a game where, like, you invested in the stock market. You had to read the newspaper. You had to, like, read the business journals to see, like, what companies were doing well and what companies weren't. And then you had to, like, balance a social life. It's absurd that this was a Nintendo game marketed towards children. But that's the kind of stuff I love. I love weird stuff like this. And it's, like, so many things going on here for me. It's Wall Street Kid, a game that I've been wanting to own since 1990, basically. It's an ex-rental. You will see all over it. If, of course, it's not going to want to focus, because the camera never does and never likes to focus, okay? But you can see video update stickers all over it. My main video store that I obsessively collect things from is Video Update. So it's a game I want. It's an ex-rental, which I'm always in favor of. And it's from Video Update. It's a score. It's a home run. Look at this. I mean, you can tell, like, the boxes really tore up, but the cartridge looks beautiful. I can't imagine this game got rented a ton, right? Like, aside from weird kids like me, who was gonna be all about Wall Street Kid? And it even has the manual. I don't know if I've ever actually read this manual before. That's very exciting to me. Now that I'm at an age where I actually have the patience to read a manual, look at this. This was your main screen in the game. This is where you went, you did business. This is my desk where I do business. Oh my God. We're gonna play the heck out of this on a live stream one of these days. I'm so excited. I wish there was some indication which video update this came from. A lot of the video update VHS tapes that I have will actually say the specific video update they were from on the label. I'm going to try to get rid of, by the way, this sticker. I like a lot of history to a tape. I like the rental stickers on it. This one is a little too, it's obscuring the wonder that is this cover. So I'm going to try to get this off. So we'll see. I've been getting pretty good at removing stickers, like gently. And another game that I was shocked to realize was not in the collection, so why not now? Bart versus the Space Mutants, right? Bart versus the Simpsons, Bart versus the Space Mutants. There you go. The full title. Give it the respect that it deserves. This one did not come with a manual, but the price was right. It looks like it was also an X rental. It's a little rough around the edges, but like I said, for the prices they were asking, I'm very happy to get it. It was probably a cheaper deal than just getting the cartridge by itself off of eBay. And I don't know, I played a lot of this game as a kid. I never got super far, but I have a lot of very fond memories of this game back in the day. Now this third game, I wish I could remember. I have a really, aside from specific memories of renting obscure Wall Street themed NES game from a local Tom Thumb gas station when I was 10 years old, a lot of my memory's real bad. And I really don't remember, I'm never paying enough attention to anything around me to remember anything. That my brain is, it's like Homer Simpson, where it's like my brain is just like a cartoon character playing banjo, and like that's what I'm thinking all the time. So I forget things, but there was definitely a time when we started doing the live streams on this channel where Groovy Movie, I'm pretty sure it was Groovy, suggested a game that we play on the live stream. It was a game I didn't own at the time. Well, guess what? Now I own it, and I own it in the box. And that game is Dance Aerobics. I will not be... Well, how about this? If we can get to 10,000 subscribers by the end of 2021... I will play this game for 8 straight hours on a live stream. How about that? Look at the back. You've got beautifully rendered 8-bit, and of course, there we go, 8-bit 80s workout power pad deliciousness. I think, does this one have... This one doesn't have the manual. Well, how am I supposed to know what to do? Oh, well. But that's a great... Is that... 1988. So that was actually pretty early on. But yeah. Just absurd. It was super cheap, and I couldn't pass it up just for the lols. For the hat hole meme that the game had sort of quietly become, at least in my own mind. So those were Nintendo games. The other thing I picked up, as some of you may know, I'm a big fan of an obscure Atari system known as the Atari 400. It was sort of marketed as a personal computer. It's somewhere in between a games console and a computer. It's still hooked up to your TV. It was maybe... So you could equate it to something like a Commodore 64. You could think of it like that, where it's It is a computer, but most people just remember using it for games. And I had one when I was a little kid. We inherited it from another family member who was super into like all of the tech and the gaming at the time back in the 80s. And I actually think the Atari 400 was late 70s. I think the first ones, I could be wrong, but I think the first ones produced were produced in like 78 or something like that. So technically, I mean, it's old. It's way old. But we had one when I was a kid. Stupidly, as a teenager, I sold it, and I've been kicking myself ever since. But I have recently reacquired the Atari 400, and so I've been on the lookout for games. And what, to my wondering eyes, should appear when we went to Punch-Out Gaming, but boxed Atari 400 games. First of all, this is what an Atari 400 game looks like. They are little, ugly, brown cartridges. I mean, some of them, get a little more creative, the third parties. Is it trying to focus? Is it even trying to focus? It hates it. It really hates this cartridge. I get it, camera. The cartridges are ugly. I get it. But this is what the cartridges look like. This is what the boxes look like. It's a little wasteful, is what I'm saying. So you've got Pac-Man, and by the way, I would have probably paid any price for this box because this is the ugliest, weirdest, most wonderful cover art for a Pac-Man game I've ever seen. Look at him. He's got buck teeth. The pellets are like pucks floating in the air. He's got this like weird, scraggly, gangly body with this weird outfit. I love it. I'm in love with this version of Pac-Man. I want to be best friends with this version of Pac-Man. It's awesome. He's wearing a t-shirt with himself on it. So he's also vain. It's great. It's so good. And what do we get in here? Oh, look at the manual. It's actually got the Pac-Man Experts Corner. So it gives you all the stats on points. So you can really, really aggressively pursue your Pac-Man career. Oh my God, look at all of the. It's just so 80s. I adore it. Or as the French say, j'adore. But it's funny to think about it. There was a time when people didn't just automatically know how Pac-Man worked, and it had to be explained in detail how Pac-Man works. You kind of take that stuff for granted nowadays. But yeah, I am so pleased. It's so silly. Look at this little cartridge just goes boop right in here, just right at the top of the box. Wonderful. And then we also got Defender, which, if you don't know Defender, it is a fantastic old arcade game. And I should say, too, this one, at some point back in 1982, was purchased from Target for $40. I will leave it up to you to find out what the, what $40 in 1982 is worth today. My guess is it's quite a bit. You can see this one's got a little art on the back of the box. Or not a little art, but a little screenshot. I'm guessing it's not a real screenshot, it's more an artist's rendition. Although that looks accurate. And I should say, too, most of these games, most of your classic arcade games, like Pac-Man, Defender, quite a few others, including Missile Command. The first place I played most of these games, these are real rough around the edges. The first place I played most of these games was on the Atari 400. So when you talk to me about, look at that instruction manual. It's got holes for a three-ring binder. That's how intense the instruction manual for Missile Command is. But when I think of these classic games, I think of the Atari 400 versions, Donkey Kong and Space Invaders. It's so ingrained, like it's so specific to me. I played most of the classics on the Atari 400. And I guess I don't know what, as far as like being 8-bit, it's certainly not in like a 16-bit category, but I would say as far as the time, especially, you're talking like 1980, I think the Atari 400 was probably way more advanced than anything else you would have in your home. But it's obviously still not quite up to arcades. I have so many memories of these games, and I'm so excited. When I got the 400, I got it plugged in, and I played through all these games just to make sure that they worked, and just the sound effects and the look and the feel, and you know, playing all these games on a joystick again was just so much fun. So sometime soon, I'm going to say in the next few live streams, we're going to do an Atari 400 live stream where I get it hooked up into OBS, and we just play Atari 400 games all night long. I'm very excited. And it's funny because a lot of, you know, I search YouTube for Atari 400 gameplay, and there isn't tons. It's obviously an obscure system, so I don't think I really found anybody live streaming Atari 400 games. So, you know, historic might be a word that gets thrown around. I don't use those words. Hero, I don't use those words, but consider it. I got Defender, Pac-Man, and Missile Command for the Atari 400, all boxed. Super cool. Most of them had some kind of paperwork included. I don't think Defender did, but that's okay. And then outside of Punch-Out Gaming, I did find a couple things at Half Price Books. If you watched my thrifting vlog, you saw this, the Museum Madness from the company that brought you Oregon Trail. They were very excited to let you know that. It says it multiple places on the box. Not that you can read it, because it just simply refuses to focus. Okay, there we go. But yeah, this game looks super fun. It looks like you go like exhibit to exhibit. I'm sure it's mostly educational, but it's, you know, it's a hip kid with his backwards baseball cap and his robot buddy learning about the Wright brothers and Galileo and the sea and probably dinosaurs. So how am I supposed to pass this up? I have a growing collection of big boxed PC games, mostly from the 90s. Look at this. Ooh! Remember when games came on like 6 discs? And you had to install one, and then it sat for 10 minutes, and then it was like, put in disc 2. I remember those days. And I don't think I showed this in the thrifting vlog, because I don't think I got good footage of it, but I found this for the Commodore 64, Into the Eagle's Nest, which, from the looks of it, it's got this cool, it opens like so, and it's got the big floppy disk in there. it kind of looks like, I don't know the timing, but it kind of looks like a maybe a predecessor to Wolfenstein. Like it almost looks like a 2D Wolfenstein. You're basically like a soldier breaking into a fortress. It sounds very similar from the description. I have no way of playing this. I grabbed it because it was relatively cheap, and I just thought it had cool cover art. So maybe someday when I get a Commodore 64 with a working floppy drive, maybe I'll get to play this. But that's what it looks like to me. It looks very Wolfenstein-y, so very cool. I'm happy to have saved it from some terrible fate. I don't know if it would have been thrown away eventually or just clearanced out, but it had been at one of my half-price books that I go to. It had been there for since long before COVID, so it's probably been there for at least a year. And it was in a locked case for quite a bit of money. I want to say 40 or $50 for a long, long time. And this time I went in and it was no longer in the case. It was just sitting on a shelf. And I think it was $10. And then I had a coupon. So the price was right. So I guess let me make sure, because I'm forgetful. That is it for today's episode. Those are all the fun, cool things I found. Some of these things are legitimately things that I have really wanted to add to the collection and am so excited to bring them home, you know? So yeah, that's it for today. Thank you everybody so much for watching. As always, I know I stress this and it's rambly and it's lame, but it is genuinely very humbling and kind. And just so nice and wonderful the support that the channel has been getting, and that you like being here, and you like communicating with each other, and I like seeing that the community grow and people becoming friends. So yeah, it's wonderful. If it's maybe your first time here, and like I haven't just knocked your socks off with how fun and nice I am, please hit that subscribe button. And if you're a regular, maybe share a video, let a friend know. If it's someone with similar interests, say, hey, that whole home video likes that stuff, you should come on down. It's turned into rambling. So I will say, folks, whether you are a dirty dog sleeping in the sun, or you are an alley rat eating up the night, you know that you are always welcome here at the video store. Bye-bye.